Welcome to the Ask Historians podcast.
Welcome to the Ask Historians podcast, a podcast set up by the moderators and the users of the online community Ask Historians. This is our pilot episode where we'll be talking about Julius Caesar. In the future, we hope to be doing interviews with flared users, interviews with any outside historians that agree to talk with us, and possibly mini-series or lectures on certain subjects. At the end of the podcast, we will be inviting suggestions for more ideas, which can be sent to modmail on the Ask Historians site. My name is Arthur, otherwise known as Artrw on the Reddit website, and we're going to be talking today to Celebreth, or Chris in real life, our resident expert on Roman and early medieval European history. So let's get right into it, Chris. What were the origins of Julius Caesar? What was he like growing up? Where did he come from? I mean, he's become such this huge figure today that pretty much everyone at least knows the name of. So, like, what was his background? How did he get to be where he eventually went?
That is a really, really big question. But funnily enough, when we look at Caesar, where he first came from was actually an extremely, relatively poor area of Rome. It was the section of Rome that was reserved for, you know, the social outcasts, people who were, you know, known for being in the area were people like foreigners and the Jews. It was in a very, very poor section of Rome that was often flooded. Think of sort of like a ghetto. He might have lived in a slightly nicer house in the ghetto, but even in a relatively nice ghetto house, it's still in the ghetto. So Caesar grew up in the ghetto. He grew up, you know, in sort of these not-so-great conditions. And what's really interesting is how he moved from those conditions, from his relatively lowly status as an individual in Rome, to possibly the greatest person that Rome has ever seen.
How did he get to be where he eventually was? How did he become such a prominent figure in Rome?
Well, I'd go ahead and say definitely have to look at his charisma. I mean, I guess probably one of his biggest factors in his favor was just his luck. I'm not sure how else to say it, but Caesar was famous for his luck. And in Rome, that just being lucky was a sign of being favored by the gods. If you were lucky, you were able to, you know, say, hey, look, the gods are on my side. Look how lucky I've been throughout my life. Caesar, I mean, if you look at his life, he was, if you believe in the Roman gods, he was definitely blessed by them. Because whatever needed to get done, the stars aligned in his favor. All the way until, well, he was murdered in front of Pompey's statue later in life. But no matter what he did, he was just damn lucky at it. And that applies to his battles, that applies to his politics, that applies to, shoot, his early life. Just him as a person, he was lucky, and he was charismatic. He knew that individuality was the name of the game. If you were an individual, if you made something of yourself that was different, that would stand out from others, then you could probably make it in Rome as something a little bit more than just a lowly politician living in a ghetto.
Awesome. So you say Caesar was charismatic and lucky, but can you talk some more about what his style would have been like as an individual? What would it have been like to meet Caesar, you know, just as a normal person? How would he have acted?
As a normal person, wow. That's another cool question, because if you think about it, something that we always forget is that these people were, well, people. I mean, it's like meeting you on the street. How would I interact with someone, you know, like Caesar if I didn't know who he was? He would, one of his best ways, just as a sort of shock factor, he would dress in the most ridiculous fashion possible for Rome. Think of today, how you see, you know, the whole different styles. You have, like, gothic styles, you have emo, you have just flamboyant in general, you have conservative, you have conserved, you have suave. Caesar made his own kind of style. He was out in his own section, almost. What he did was, he copied the Greeks in some aspects, in that his toga was longer than as was usual for the Romans, it went all the way down to his ankles, which was, how dare he? He had a fringe on his toga. That was a pretty big deal. I mean, so like, that's such a weird style. He added long sleeves, and his toga was almost relatively transparent, which, scandalous, obviously. And finally, he wore it loosely belted. We see actually a lot of references to some of his opponents, especially one of his major opponents was a rather large figure in Roman history that no one's ever heard about, Lucius Cornelius Sulla, who was a dictator of Rome. And there's one point where Caesar was actually in exile, in air quotes, and Sulla was convinced to let him back into the city without killing him. And he said to these people who convinced him, okay, fine, but I'm warning you, beware that loosely girded boy, because in him are 1,000 Mariuses. And Marius was a gentleman who had, you know, caused a civil war in Rome, caused huge uprisings, pretty much through the entire Roman world through a loop. And he says, in Caesar, there's 1,000 of this guy, and describes him with a loose belt. But that just helps us visualize this guy. So we've got this guy in a long flowing toga, maybe a little bit thinner than normal. He had long sleeves with fringes, and he wore his belt loose. And he was very, very outgoing, very charismatic, as I mentioned, but very flamboyant for his day. We could probably imagine that, you know, his tunic might have been a brighter color. He's known for having very specific tastes, and he liked pearls especially, which is interesting enough. There's another tale of, this one's not exactly necessarily completely accurate, but he ordered a house to be built outside Rome when he had, you know, people he could borrow money from. So he borrowed all this money, and he asked for this massive house. And when they had the frame built, he looked at it, he decided, you know what, that's not quite what I wanted. So he says, tear it all down, and let's rebuild it in a different style. That's the kind of person Caesar was. He wanted what he wanted, and he got what he wanted. And if he didn't get what he wanted, well, he would work around it so that he still got what he wanted, if that makes sense. So we have an individual who's hard to read. I mean, you look at him and you see he was a politician. Just straight out, he was a politician. But he was different. He had something to him that just, it made people want to do what he wanted them to do. It made them want to follow this man. And he had something to him, that's for sure.
Going back to Caesar's scandalousness, I've heard some rumors of Caesar's kind of womanizing ways. Heard he was a bit of a womanizer. Could you speak to the extent of the truth of that?
Caesar's, I think, one of the best ways to just summarize Caesar's womanizing ways, as you might say, was a song. You know, when soldiers came back with their victorious general, they had something called a triumph in Rome. Think of today a Mardi Gras parade. You know, a big old parade with, you know, floats that advertise, and they're throwing out little trinkets, and you've got all these soldiers in shining armor, and behind them you have 8 white horses drawing a chariot with that victorious general clad in, you know, resplendent clothes, his face painted red with a slave beside him, just whispering in his ear, remember, you are mortal. Because for this day, he was representing Jupiter, the king of the gods. He was the number one person in Rome when he had this triumph. But of course, you've also got to remember, there are a lot of soldiers. And these soldiers have just been on campaign. They are just coming home to Rome, and it's a party. As I said, it's Mardi Gras. So, I mean, they're not going to be super serious about this. So, something they did when they came into Rome on this triumph was they sang just a sort of song. And paraphrasing that song, essentially what they said was, oh, hey, you husbands of Rome, you might want to lock your wives up. We've got the bald adulterer over here. He just spent all your tax money in Gaul sleeping with their women, and he came back to Rome to sleep with yours. Congratulations. That's the kind of person Caesar was. If it was on 2 legs, and if it was a woman, he would sleep with it. That's we have records of him sleeping with half the wives of the senators, who are supposedly the preeminent men of Rome. He slept with, you know, other people's wives. He didn't care. He slept with their sisters. He didn't care about that other. He slept with their daughters. Eh, he didn't mind. He slept with slaves. He slept with other people. If he slept with Cleopatra. Actually fathered a child on Cleopatra. But Caesar was... sometimes I wish I had his talent. Let's just put it that way. But as you can imagine, that sort of impacted his politics a little bit, because he wasn't exactly covert about sleeping with everything that moved. He was caught out quite a few times and managed to just put on his charming face and just talk his way out of it. Like, there was one time in the Senate. It was during the Catiline conspiracy, which was a big deal. I'm trying to find a modern example. Maybe the McCarthy scare, where they found a communist. They found a legitimate communist, and they had proof that he was a communist, and he was a bad person. By the way, he's trying to overthrow the government. So they have him in jail, and they're holding an emergency meeting of the Senate. And the consuls, one of the consuls was a gentleman named Cicero, who you might have heard of. He's a very famous orator. He's, you know, he's got a voice that can sway people. Just very beautiful speaker from what we know. And, you know, he puts in humor in his speeches, too, if you've read his stuff. He was the consul, and he was the one in charge, because consuls were, think of, like, the Roman version of the United States president. Not quite the same, but they were the head of the government, per se. They were the top magistrates. They weren't necessarily in charge of everything, but they were the top dogs. Sounds a bit strange, but I'll just go on with it. Either way, he was consul at the time. And this consul was, you know, he sees sedition. I mean, he sees this guy trying to overthrow the Roman government and take it over. Make himself a king. That was a huge deal to the Romans. So, of course, you know, Cicero's advocating, let's kill him. Let's execute this guy. This is high treason. We've got to kill him. We've got to get rid of this, because this is evil. In all ways, he's trying to overthrow our freedom. So, of course, Caesar comes up and he makes a really eloquent speech in favor of not killing him, because that would be illegal. Because one of the few huge big no-nos, you cannot execute a Roman citizen without a trial. Period. End of story, you can't do it. So that's what Caesar was saying. It's illegal. You just can't do that. Well, unfortunately for him, he had a major enemy in the Senate, and that enemy's name was Cato. Cato Minor, or Cato the Younger. And Cato comes up afterwards and he says, Caesar, I think you're trying not to get him killed because you're in with him. I think you're on his side. And of course, coincidentally enough, right at this time, right when Cato's making the speech about Caesar being an evil ingrate who's in with this treacherous dog who's trying to overthrow the Roman system of life, a messenger comes in. And that messenger brings Caesar a note. It's a slave, obviously, and he leaves. And Caesar glances at the note and tucks it away. But, of course, everyone sees this, and Cato just latches onto it immediately, saying, pointing at Caesar and saying, hey, look, he just got a message. I guarantee you that message is from one of the supporters of Catiline. Show us that message. I want you to read that message in front of everyone here. Caesar's like, no, trust me, you don't want to see it. Just leave it alone, go on with your speech. So, of course, Cato being the political opponent he is, you've got to think, Caesar probably knew that Cato was going to demand to see it anyway, which is the reason he demurred and said, no, you didn't want to see it. So, of course, Cato wants to see it even more. So Cato says, show it, give it here or else. And Caesar's like, okay, you know what, here you go, read it aloud. So Cato goes up and takes the message and reads it aloud. And it turns out it was an extremely explicit love letter from Cato's sister, which, in front of the entire Senate, which, as you can imagine, did not exactly endear Cato to Caesar, and it didn't exactly help Cato's cause that Caesar was evil supporter of Catiline. One funny thing is we don't actually know whether... We don't know much about the Catiline conspiracy. But what we do know is that Cato's sister was actually one of Caesar's longest-lasting flings. He slept with her, and he slept with her daughter. Interestingly enough, she supposedly got her daughter to sleep with Caesar, but that's neither here nor there.
So that was her doing then.
Oh, yes.
Interesting. Switching gears a bit from the sexual life of Caesar, can you talk a little bit about Caesar's role in the triumvirate?
Oh, the great triumvirate. Well, the thing about the triumvirate was there were a few great men in Rome at this time, the people who had just risen up through the ranks and were well-known as just great people. They were huge names. They were household names. They were famous. They, you know, at least one of them had held at least one triumph. He'd held multiple triumphs, I believe. His name was Pompey, and he was known as Pompey Magnus, or Pompey the Great. And Pompey was essentially the greatest general in Rome at this time. Since he was a young boy, he was one of the greatest generals in the world. Well, the Roman world. That was the entire world to them. But there was another great man, and this man was known for being the wealthiest man in Rome. The wealthiest, and obviously, because he was the wealthiest, one of the most politically powerful men of Rome. And his name was Crassus, Marcus Licinius Crassus. Now, you have Crassus, the richest man in Rome, who's, you know, footing the bill for a ton of politicians. And you have Pompey, this great general of Rome, who's also very rich because he was a great general. He stole people's stuff. And they hate each other. They can't stand each other. As a matter of fact, they were both consul at one point in time. And as Plutarch notes, Plutarch is one of our great sources, you know, from the ancient world. He notes, nothing got done. They hated each other so much that all they would do is veto everything the other person said, which sounds sort of like the modern United States Senate and House of Representatives. They just can't get along, so nothing gets done. But there was one thing that they achieved a relative note during their consulship, and that was they had a massive feast, Hercules, one of their gods. And Hercules, of course, you know, was a relatively big guy to the Romans. So they had this massive feast for everyone in Rome. And everyone in Rome got 3 months of free grain and as much food as they wanted, and Crassus footed the bill for all of it. So, you know, it's a big old feast. Everyone's getting drunk. Everyone's eating everything in sight. And, you know, a young nobleman, no one even knows his name. He comes up there, stands up, you know, with a glass of wine, says, okay, guys, I had a dream last night, and in that dream, Pompey and Crassus actually got along together, which, of course, you can imagine everyone thought was hilarious because everyone knew they couldn't stand each other. And you can imagine a good number of them were drunk at this point, so they all, you know, made a loud noise and say, yeah, yeah, okay, you know what, Pompey, Crassus, get along, and neither of them were very happy with this prospect, and Pompey sat in his seat, rather stone-faced, and you can imagine he's sort of thinking, yeah, when hell freezes over. But Crassus, clever politician that he is, he stands up and says, okay, guys, okay, I'm going to make it up to Pompey. I'm extending my hand of friendship to Pompey. Remember, this is the same guy you guys called great before he was old enough to be great and held a triumph before he even had hair on his chin. But I'm still being his friend. Crassus was a little bit of an asshole. By the way, so you have these two great men, these big names. And then you have this rising star. He's been consul once. He did a pretty damn good job when he was. But his name was Caesar. Notice, there are two great men, and then there's one rising star. When the triumvirate was formed, it was these three guys making an agreement. But Caesar was essentially the glue that forced the other two to stay together. Because he was Pompey's father-in-law. Because Pompey had married Caesar's daughter. Well, Caesar's financial connection to Crassus. Crassus had footed the bill for most of Caesar's politics. So Crassus liked Caesar, because Caesar was helping Crassus politically. Pompey liked Caesar, because they were related by blood, if you want to say that. So he was able to cement this alliance of three great men. But he was still the least important partner in that alliance. The other two, they were the big guys. He was just the puppet master in the shadows. He was the one who was able to actually make a triumvirate work out. And with him there, hey, great. And what he was able to do with that triumvirate was try to get himself out of debt. Because he wasn't only in debt to Crassus, but he spent lavishly no matter what he did. Because he was Caesar. And he, you know, I trusted to his luck that everything would work out fine. So, you know, he spent whatever the heck he wanted. When people, there's actually another story about him when he was running for an office. And the other guy said, okay, Caesar, you know what? I'm going to pay you just to step out of this. I'll pay off all your debts that you've incurred by starting this campaign. Caesar, of course, being the smartass that he was, told the other guy, okay, you know what? I'm doubling my spending. And he went on to win that election. So you can see the kind of person that Caesar was. He had a lot of debts to a lot of people, which wasn't something he wanted. And, of course, there's one major way to settle your debts in Rome is, you know, by getting a lot of money, is by going to war. And that's exactly what Caesar did to try to settle his debts.
So, to talk a little bit about some of the wars that Caesar was involved in, let's talk about Gaul. Why did Caesar decide to invade Gaul, and could Gaul be considered a genocide?
Well, why did he decide to invade Gaul? The original reason was, as I just mentioned, Caesar was broke. He was, you know, the biggest man in Rome. He had jewels, and he had nice clothes, and he was flamboyant, and he had a nice house, and oh, the whole nine yards. And he was so ridiculously broke, he made the United States debt look really, really, really small. So he needed to get money from somewhere, because his, you know, the people who were footing the bill for all this were sort of like, well, I'm not giving you any more money until you give me something back. So, the bills are starting to come due, mate. And Caesar knew that, and he had himself appointed as, you know, one of the triumvirs. They appointed themselves different areas of the Roman Republic to rule. Pompey was able to secure great holdings, because Pompey had the East, like Greece and Pontus, as his governorship. Caesar got the Gallic area, which originally, interestingly enough, didn't even include the area we think now of as France. It included northern Italy. It included Transalpine Gaul, which is the beyond the Alps, the Alpine Mountains. It included the Cisalpine Gaul. Italy, actually, as we think of it today, it's south of the Alps, and it included a strip of land all the way up to Spain. So you got this little strip of land, it's not that big, but then you have this area north of it, just known as Gaul. And Caesar decided that as a casus belli, or as a excuse to go to war, really, he was going to say, I'm fighting a preemptive war against these Gauls. They've invaded Rome in the past, and they sacked Rome before. This was over 300 years before Caesar invaded Gaul, was when the Gauls actually sacked Rome. But he's preventing the Gauls from invading again, okay? Because he's going to take the war to Gaul, and he's going to fight off those barbarians that are threatening Rome every day. Despite the fact these barbarians were not actually threatening Rome. But Caesar knew he needed the money, and the best way to get money in the ancient world was to go to war and take the money from other people who had it. So he invaded Gaul and made himself extraordinarily rich, paid off all his debts, worked out like a bloody charm. But, of course, you know, it sort of sparked a whole bunch of other issues. Whether or not you can consider Gaul a genocide, I'm going to go ahead and just say, absolutely not. Caesar did not invade Gaul to kill Gauls. He invaded Gaul to make himself more famous, make himself richer, and because, well, it was an easy target. He didn't invade Gaul because he hated the Gallic people to an extent that he wanted to exterminate them all. He killed, according to him, 1 million Gauls and enslaved 1 million more. But even those numbers, though they're probably completely out of proportion, are, I don't want to say minor, but they don't classify a genocide. In a genocide, you wouldn't be enslaving 1 million Gauls. You would be killing every Gaul you saw.
So, how about the Gallic Wars, which is the information put out by Caesar to Rome to kind of inform of exactly that, the Gallic Wars. How accurate was that, or would it be considered more of a propaganda piece today? And then beyond that, how would it have been dispersed among the Roman public? How would the Roman public have come in contact with the Gallic Wars?
Well, that's actually something that's sort of debated, but the general idea of the Gallic Wars is what Caesar would do is he would write them. One of the theories I've heard is that he would write them, say, during the winter when he wasn't campaigning as much. He was settled in. He would go ahead and write these correspondences, and he would send them off to Rome with his official dispatch to the Senate. And what they would do was they would have the criers read these out, which is the reason that they're written all in third person. So you would hear, "Caesar, resplendent in his red cape, commanded our troops, and he's carried a few cohorts of his troops behind, or our troops." He always referred to them as our men, our troops. You see what he's getting at there? You know, he's associating himself with the people very much. It's brilliant writing.
Creating a sense of nationalism.
Exactly. And that's something that, you know, it was huge among the Romans because they take pride in that. They see these troops fighting in Gaul as our boys, our men. Those are our soldiers who are fighting those Gauls. And they're being heroic and they're being awesome. And Caesar had tons of these heroic, awesome stories. He had, you know, exciting moments. He had terrifying moments. He had, you know, oh my gosh, are they going to make it? How are they going to get out of this one? It's beautiful, beautiful writing that's meant to grip you and pull you in. And that's actually, if you read it today, that's the effect it has on you. You can't stop reading it. It's almost like you're reading a fantasy book, except that actually happened. And going on to your question, was it propaganda? Absolutely it was propaganda. Those things were written to make Caesar look amazing and as spectacular as possible. Everything that goes wrong, never, not a moment of it was Caesar's fault. Of course, because Caesar never does anything wrong. Caesar did everything right, and people under him made some mistakes, but Caesar, being the nice, kind person that he was, forgave them those mistakes, and they learned from those mistakes and became great men as a result. But it was only because of Caesar that they became great men. Don't forget that part. So, yeah, it was propaganda, but the thing about it is, it also was accurate to an extent, because back in Rome, Caesar had a lot of political enemies that he'd made, especially Cato the Younger, who I mentioned earlier. They were looking for any chance they could get to just to jump on Caesar and just drag his name through the mud, just make him out to be a pariah of the people. They would, you know, the gossip chain through Rome was one of the biggest carriers of news, and it could make or break politicians. Caesar had used it to raise himself to glory. They wanted to use it to bring him down. So if, you know, he had his official dispatches to the Senate as to what was going on, there were other people in Caesar's army who would report to their benefactors in the Senate. And if he had said something that wasn't true, blatantly untrue in the Gallic Wars, then those political opponents would have latched onto that just faster than a leech would have latched onto a bloody piece of meat in the water. They would have just swarmed him, cried him out through the streets. "Oh, Caesar, he claims he does all this, but look at what he actually did. He was not that great. He was just a liar. He's carrying on this war in Gaul, getting our men killed for no reason whatsoever. He's terrible. He's bad. He should be, you know, dragged into court and made to answer for his crimes." So, while the Gallic Wars was obvious propaganda, it's also extraordinarily accurate and beautifully written, if I haven't mentioned that quite yet.
So not so much that there's any falsities within the Gallic Wars, but more so that it's just specifically paying attention to the successes as a move of political savviness by Julius Caesar.
Yes, and minimizing anything that went absolutely wrong, or just apportioning the blame to everyone but Caesar.
Great. So let's talk about Caesar's later years after Gaul. What was Caesar up to, essentially, after Gaul? What did he do after that campaign was over with?
Well, funnily enough, and I believe it was the year he finished the Gallic War, when he said all Gaul is subdued, or all Gaul is pacified, rather. That was the one year of his life where he was truly never on campaign. The only other year that could be classified as his last year. And he was killed 4 days before he was heading off to another campaign, so I don't count it. Plus, it was just March, so that doesn't count as a whole year. That's only 3 months. But that was the only year after he left Gaul when he wasn't on campaign, and he was solidifying control in Gaul. And that solidification of Roman control lasted essentially forever. To this day, that's why we've got, you know, French as a language is so different from German. It's because the Roman control over that area was so solid that it created an entirely different culture, an entirely different society than the barbarian Germans. After that, Caesar was unfortunately being out-politicked. He was on military campaign for a long while over in Gaul, and he'd overextended his office. This was the equivalent of a president staying in office for an extra term beyond what he was allowed because they voted to allow him that extra term. It was sort of extra legal, and his political opponents were taking full advantage of it. He spent 10 years in Gaul, I believe. When he spent all that time in Gaul, you know, his political opponents had plenty of time just to say whatever they wanted about him. And he wasn't there to counter those rumors, counter all the slander that was going on. So he had quite an opposition. And the thing about Roman politics was, you were safe from being in court. You could not be pulled before a court as long as you were in office. So all they had to do was wait for his proconsulship, his governorship, to be over and done with. And as soon as that was over, he was screwed politically. He was going to be pulled in front of the courts, probably charged with, you name it, you know, bribery, corruption, scandal, electoral manipulation. Everyone manipulated elections in Rome. But the joke was, if you don't get caught, you didn't do it. Oh, rah, rah, rah. If no one charges you with it, you weren't actually guilty. Well, everyone did it, and that was one of the things he was going to be charged for. He was also going to be charged for starting that war in Gaul, which was not voted on by the Roman people, not approved by the Roman people, and they probably didn't want anything to do with it, but it made them rich, and Caesar did it anyway, so why not, right? I mean, what are you going to do? Stop him? So, he was going to be dragged before the courts, and the head guy in Rome, or one of them, was Pompey Magnus. Crassus had died. He'd been killed on a campaign in Parthia. Caesar's daughter had died. Caesar had no more links to Pompey. While they were still political allies, they had no other links binding them together. And as a result, they became polarized, because Caesar, over in Gaul, Pompey was surrounded by Roman politicians who were opponents of Caesar. And those Roman politicians got Pompey on their side and had him say to Caesar, disband all your troops and come back to Rome. Your term of office is over. You're coming back to Rome as a normal citizen. Needless to say, Caesar wasn't very happy with this arrangement because he was sort of getting screwed with it. Pompey, whatever, but Caesar knew that there was no way he could do this. If he actually went along with Pompey's request, then he would be absolutely destroying not only his political career, but possibly his life. He'd be committing suicide by walking into Rome, political and possibly physical. And he just couldn't. If you look at him, at this point, he was stuck between a rock and a hard place. And it was a game of brinksmanship. Just one of those games of brinksmanship, just like the Senate is doing today in the United States Senate, and the House, you know, the entire government. They were brought to a point of, oh, who's going to budge first? Who's going to budge first? Who's going to budge first? That game of chicken. And no one budged. Caesar decided that, you know what? To hell with this. He brought one legion with him. Just one legion. And he brought it to the Rubicon. And stepping across the Rubicon, which is the river that, you know, signified the boundaries of Rome, he said, you know, the die is cast. Let whatever happens happen. I just called your bluff. Of course, Pompey, you know, he was pretty arrogant about this. He didn't believe Caesar would do this. No one believed Caesar would do this. Everyone was like, Caesar's going to disband his armies. We're going to come to some sort of agreement. It's going to be okay. But Caesar, he's Caesar. He's not predictable. So he walks across the Rubicon, which is, it's not a very big river. It's like the stream. It's no big deal. And Pompey, who previously declared, I can stamp my feet and entire legions will rise up out of the ground to defend Rome. Well, he stamped his feet and no legions came. So he sort of panicked, you know, along with his whole coterie of senators. And they fled to the only place they could flee to, which is Pompey's holdings over in the east, over in Greece. So over in Greece, Pompey decided, you know, he's going to start raising his legions and start getting them together. He had client states, which is, you know, they were nation states almost. They were indebted to him that, you know, owed him fealty, you might say. And they would give him money, they would give him troops, they'd get him supplies, because he essentially owned them. So he got all his troops from there. But these troops, they were novices. They were new troops. They were untried. They were green, is the best word for it. And Caesar's troops had just been through 10 years of warfare in Gaul. 10 years of war. Those veterans are hard-bitten dudes. I mean, if you look at Caesar's Civil War, he never had more than, you know, half the number of men that Pompey ever had. And yet he only lost one battle. And that wasn't even a decisive victory for Pompey because he didn't follow it up. Either way, Caesar was able to, come out on top in that civil war. He destroyed Pompey's army. And Pompey himself was forced to flee in a little boat to Egypt. To try, because Egypt was another of one of his client states, and he tried to raise some more armies there. But unfortunately for him, he had his head cut off, Caesar following him, arrived in Egypt, and had Pompey's head presented to him. Caesar, needless to say, was not very happy about this, and sort of took over the administration of Egypt, which is where he met Cleopatra. They had happy fun times, making babies, and fighting in civil wars, because Egypt was far from politically stable at this time. And then, after the whole making babies bit, Caesar decided that he was going to finish up the civil war, and he headed over to Spain, where Pompey's son had another army. And this was the Battle of Munda. This was a battle where Caesar said, you know, in other battles I fought for victory. At Munda, I fought for my life. And that's something coming from Caesar, who's, at this point, he's not a young guy. He's, you know, in his late 50s, early 60s. He's an elderly kid. This was in his 50s. Either way, he was not a young spring chicken. He, you know, was fighting this battle, and it was against another green army. But this green army fought so viciously, they pushed Caesar's army back. Caesar's army was on the brink of retreating. So what Caesar did was, he grabbed a shield from one of his men. In the back line, he walked in front of all his men to 10 paces away from the Pompeian legions. He just stood there. I mean, think of it in your head, these massive armies, and just Caesar walking to the front, just being fucking Caesar, with a shield, So, of course, you know, all of them just start chunking everything they possibly can at him, and miraculously, he survives it. He takes a whole ton of missiles on his shield. You know, one source calls it 100 missiles on his shield, which is probably BS, but he dodges missiles, he takes them on his shield, until his men panic seeing him up there and rush forward to protect him, eventually winning the battle. But that just shows the kinds of things that Caesar was willing to do for victory is just do the most ridiculous thing possible and just offering himself, just saying, okay, you know what, if you guys aren't going to fight, I am. What do you do when your leader who's led you for this long just does something like that? You're forced to fight. That's one of the things that just shows Caesar's genius. Even when he was elderly, he was sick. He had epilepsy and was getting really bad, but he was a genius.
Tell us, how exactly did Caesar die? What were the circumstances surrounding that?
What was the circumstances? Big one. Well, remember when I mentioned those political opponents? Caesar, when he came back to Rome, had declared himself dictator for life. He was the top guy in Rome, but, I mean, he wanted room to be able to fix Rome the way he wanted Rome to be fixed. So he spent some time in Rome just trying to fix things, trying to get things to work out properly, ironing out all the difficulties that had led to all these civil wars in the first place. I personally believe that if Caesar had had his way and he'd not been killed, there might have been less empire to the Roman Republic and more of a continuation. However, unfortunately, the senators didn't agree with that. The whole dictator for life thing really got to them. And, of course, Caesar decided, you know, he's going to go to war again. He's sick of all this politicking in Rome. He's been to war. War's way more fun than politics anyway. So he's organized another campaign, this one into a place called Parthia, which was the gravesite of Crassus. He wanted Crassus's, the eagles that his legions carried, the standards, the soul of every legion, were captured by the Parthians. And Caesar wanted those back. He wanted those badly. So he organized an entire campaign of Parthia. And just a few days before he was scheduled to leave, 4 days before he was scheduled to leave, he went to this meeting that had been called of the Senate. It was just another meeting, standard thing. And, you know, his wife warns him before, supposedly, hearsay. In a dream she'd seen him in, you know, on his grave and his soldiers surrounding him. She begged him just to stay indoors today. There was a soothsayer that warned him, Caesar, beware the Ides of March. And this was the Ides of March. And he actually passed to the soothsayer on his way out, and he says, yeah, it's the Ides of March. I'm still here. I'm doing great. I'm feeling pretty good, actually. You know, look, it's a beautiful day. The soothsayer says to him, yeah, it's the Ides of March, Caesar. But the Ides of March are not yet gone. So, of course, he continues on. And a messenger catches up to him. This messenger is from a senator who's on his side, who's gotten wind of this plot to kill Caesar. And Caesar, he hands Caesar the message and says, read this as soon as you possibly can. So Caesar says, okay. He puts the message, you know, he holds on to the message, and the crowd's just pushing him along because it's a big crowd. Caesar's a popular guy. Everyone's trying to curry favor with him. He doesn't bother reading the message instantly, and the messenger disappears. So he's got this message in his hand, and he's heading on into the Senate. And we can only assume, you know, he's going to read the message when he gets the chance, or he's forgotten about it entirely. And then he sits down and is just listening to these people. And all of a sudden, one of them grabs his toga and yanks it down, which is a bit sort of like someone just grabbing someone's jacket and tearing it off them. I mean, it's like, what are you doing? Caesar turns and says, what the hell do you think you're doing? So, of course, this guy pulls out a dagger and just stabs him. And then the other senators, obviously, who were in on it, all swarm Caesar. And for all accounts, he grabs a pen and starts fighting back. I mean, he stabs the guy through the hand and nails the hand to the ground, but there's a whole ton of people just swarming Caesar, stabbing him 27, 28 times. Apparently, On later analysis, only one of those wounds was fatal, but that was enough to kill him, and he still had that note clutched in his hand when he died. So, these senators run out of the Senate. They're clutching their bloody daggers, and they're shouting, "Yes! Death to tyrants! Thus ends all tyrants!" At something that, actually, the state of Virginia took in the United States Civil War. Thus, sic semper tyrannis. Thus ends tyrants.
Well, thank you for that informative, very abridged, but still very entertaining, full-circle history of the life of Julius Caesar. One more point of information I'd like to touch on before we finish here, because I think it is important to know, is Julius Caesar, not the actual pronunciation of that name, even though it's the name we've been using in this podcast, just for simplicity's sake. So would you mind touching on, just for a brief moment, what is the correct pronunciation of Julius Caesar, and why has that pronunciation kind of been lost and replaced with the more popular pronunciation that we've been using today?
Oh, it's no problem. It's just because his name has been anglicized. Like, say, Pompey Magnus is now known as Pompey the Great. Marcus Antonius is now known as Mark Antony. Caius Julius Caesar is now known as Gaius Julius Caesar. It's just because it's been anglicized.
All right. Pretty simple explanation. All right. Thanks for joining us, Celebreth. That was wonderful. A great first pilot episode to the Ask Historians podcast. To those listening, please keep in touch with the Ask Historians page and watch for future Ask Historians podcast. And please send any suggestions on how we can improve the podcast, or maybe suggestions you have for future podcasts, into the Ask Historians mod mail, which is accessible at www.reddit.com/r/AskHistorians. On the sidebar, right above the list of all the names of the moderators. See you hopefully soon in our next podcast.
You've been listening to the Ask Historians podcast. For more history like this, visit us at reddit.com/r/AskHistorians and ask over 100 historians and enthusiasts anything you want to know in history. Find us on Twitter as @AskHistorians and subscribe to the show on iTunes. Or visit askhistorians.libsyn.com. Thank you very much for listening. And join us next time on the Ask Historians podcast.